You've all seen Ryan Serhant killing major sales and building a massive team, but he started a real estate brokerage. Don't make that same mistake. I'm going to get into exactly why it's a really large mistake that he did that. But before we get into everything, please like and subscribe to this channel. Please comment if you have anything you'd like to add to the conversation. And I'd love to see you on these videos. Please continue engaging with me. Let's get straight into this. Now, brokerage ownership for Ryan Serhant is a massive misfire. His brand has the opportunity to be global, have global impact. Everybody knows his name, everybody knows who he is. The problem with brokerage ownership, the biggest problem for Ryan Serhant, is that it is a micro market opportunity. The people in his micro market want to join Serhant Brokerage, but the problem becomes they can't join him if they're in Arizona. They can't join him if they're in Australia. They can't join him if they're in the UK. They have to be in his micro market. So the only way to expand is open up new offices, gain new licenses, etc. When he has a worldwide brand and he's not able to capitalize on the eyeballs, attention, and influence that he's developed over the years. So let's get straight into some of the background information. We're going to get into a little meat in this video of how to actually start a brokerage, and then I'm going to get into why you potentially might not want to. So to start a brokerage, you have to start from the ground up. Usually you have to have the original license. So you have a real estate agent license. You're going to have to get your secondary license in 99% of your markets. You're going to have a broker's license. Once you now have attained that broker's license, you're going to have to get a company. I would say build out a brand of what you want your brokerage to be called before you even make your company's name. Now, you build out an entire brand, you build out an entire brand story, a tagline for your brand, a logo for your brand, build out the tangibles for your brand, and now you take that license that you have, that secondary brokerage license that you have, and take it to your Department of Licensing or your Department of Revenue, and you merge that and you apply for a real estate brokerage firm license, attaching your brokerage license to that entity. So create an LLC, use the name of the brand that you created, use some of the tangible materials that you already had to connect it to that so you can get some trademarks and some designs so that no competitors start using your exact information, your exact branding. You would be terrible if you allowed that to happen. So you sit there and you create that. Now you have your brokerage licensed. Let's say that takes about a week. After that, you now have to get a Department of Revenue. You have to create an EIN, which is effectively your social security for your business. Now, once you have your EIN number at the Department of Revenue, you can now go to a bank. Go to the bank and create a business account. With that business account, you need to make sure that you have the ability to send out wires in excess of $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, especially depending on your market. You need to make sure that you can send out more than $100,000 to various agents per day. And there's different requirements and different capital requirements in those banks to even allow that, and different banks have different regulations, so make sure you do all the research that you have for that and know that every single time you send out a wire or a transfer to one of your agents, you're paying usually about $15 just to send that wire. So maybe do some shopping around, maybe you can find it for 10, not sure, but then you find out the bank, you solidify that bank, and now you have to find premises. Then you're going to build out an office. You're going to try to find agents. Agents are the lifeblood of a real estate brokerage. And no matter what anybody says ever, the better agents they go for, the harder it is to grow, scale, and actually make a profit. Now, when I started my real estate brokerage, our main goal was to only have high producers, have a small core team, sell the highest luxury properties, which everybody really wants to do. There's a few problems with that. Number one, everybody wants the best brokers. Everybody wants the top producers. Everybody wants the best properties. But what happens is there's a cap to that. There's a cap to the amount of agents that you're gonna have in your marketplace. There's a cap to the amount of properties that fit that profile in your marketplace. And when you start delving into all of the specifics, the specific buckets that these agents can fulfill, you realize that 95% of the agent marketplace, or all of the agents running around, are average producing agents. And the best way to actually grow your business is by getting average agents to be interested in what you do, what you offer, your training, your resources, and your services. Now, I'm gonna take 5 steps back here, because now all you've done is you've built the brand, you've added the licenses, and now you have the ability to start hiring on agents. You don't have any resources, you don't have any tools, you don't have any branding, you don't have any marketing, you don't have a structure, you don't have an office, you don't have any compliance systems in place. So we're gonna have to address all of that. And you also don't have a CRM, you don't have a website, you don't have cards, you don't have tactile materials. And we're going to have to address every single one of these so that you can have a well-functioning real estate brokerage. To start, let's say making cards is easy, so you make your first set of cards. Let's say making listing signs is easy and open signs is easy, so you have all of those done by a marketing team and you have the templates on file. Then after that, you have flyer designs and brochure designs and swag created, because agents love to see swag. You know, when I owned Park Place, they loved to see hats and shirts and signs and, you know, artwork and whatever you have, because it really leans into the brand that you're creating so that people can get excited about it. Now all you've done is create the marketing and the image and the aesthetic, but we also need back end. That's what brokerage services are all actually about. There's a big problem in the entire industry that makes the entire industry disjointed. People think that real estate brokerage is about training and helping agents grow and resources and software systems and all that, which we're gonna get into what you're gonna need as a bare minimum moving forward in your venture. But what I would actually say is true is that agents don't join offices for that. They join offices for the bare minimum compliance requirements, which is why real estate brokerage fees have been going down every single decade over the last 50 years. They're not going up, they're going down, because brokerage services can be largely automated, largely put into a category of very fast services. And what agents want is the extra tools, resources, and everything else over and above that, which is why, and I'm gonna take one quick pivot here, which is why I merged my entire brokerage into the best group at eXp, because they take care of the compliance side that has almost no value to the growth of your company. And they allow you to focus on the growth aspect, which is what the agents actually want to pay money for. And let me step back in. Now, why do they actually want to pay money for the growth aspect? I'll give you an easy example. If I have a lead for a new agent and I say, hey, here is a seller, they're going to sell their house 100%. All you have to do is do the process of the sale of their home, and I will give you half of that sale. About 99% of new agents are going to jump up and down and say, that's amazing, I would love to co-list that listing with you and do all of the work for you. But that's half. They will take a 50% hit on that. But how many agents in the marketplace today are going around saying, I'm happy to take a 50% cut on my real estate brokerage? None. None of them are doing that. So why is it that a team can still come in and command 25% over what the real estate brokerage is charging? Because the team is offering the agent what they actually want. The brokerage compliance is just there as a necessity. So let's figure out what's all required as a back-end necessity for no reason, and the agents don't care about it. You're going to first need a software system that compiles all your data. You could be looking at a BrokerMint or a SkySlope or a you know, paperless pipeline, one of those software systems. You're now going to have to create a template and a process to what you require all of your agents to do. You're also going to have to create a system and a workflow for how you're going to actually review those documents. I would suggest you don't review them yourself. Hire a manager immediately, because if you plan on scaling your business to any size of any kind, you are not going to be wanting to be the face of that business. Because if you are, say you build to 50 agents and you're the face of it, placing a manager in your stead is going to be very difficult, because people will not take to that. It will become a point of contention in the growth of your business. So you're going to not only have to create an entire system and process around paperwork and compliance and review, it's likely best practices to hire an entire broker to run your brokerage for you, and you'd just be the owner. Now, got to take another three steps to the left and explain why the heck would you own something when, and you have the secondary license, but now you're gonna have to hire somebody to do that work for you anyways. Doesn't make any logical sense. And why is 99% of the brokerage owners in the entire country the actual broker of record? They're the designated broker of their own brokerage. If it was such a great business, why are there not owners and random buyer investors running into the marketplace asking to buy real estate brokerages? It's because if you look at the average brokerage size, brokerage owners are profiting like $100,000 a year if they're lucky. Over the last year and a half, 2 years, most brokerages are actually losing money, because of all the liabilities, because of the software, because of having an email domain, because of having a website, because of having SEO, because of staff, because of their overhead of their corporate space. So if you're gonna be a brokerage owner, you're gonna wanna do things differently to make sure that you can actually make some money. Now, I'm gonna also guess, and this is maybe a little bit of an educated guess, but if you're even considering opening a real estate brokerage and you've made it this far in the video, you're probably already a producing agent. You are probably already doing lots of sales or running a team. The problem is if you take your eye off the ball of your sales and of running your team and of doing your production, you're going to take a very large hit on income. And I can tell you this, it will not very likely come back. The average real estate brokerage size in the United States of America is under 20. If you get over 20, you are the top 10% of brokerages that are ever formed. And that's being generous. If you get to 50, you're more than the top 1%. If you get to 100, you're the 1% of the 1%, almost of the 1% of brokerage owners. And I can tell you now, if you get to over 100 agents, you're going to be lucky to be making $250,000 a year in free cash flow. Now, does it make sense to take on that risk, liability, capital expenditure, salaried employees, leases, and all of that extra software contracts, and potentially lawsuits, which I know are a pain, having dealt with them myself? It does not pencil. Now, what does? What does pencil? What we decided to do, we decided to merge our entire entity into eXp Realty, and they take care of all of the brokerage liabilities, the softwares, the compliance structures, the paperwork review, the licensing, the E&O, all of it. What we do now is we focus on the things that agents want to pay for. And the beauty of our model is not only do they want to pay for them, we give them so much value, they assume that we would charge them 25% like all the other brokerages do. But we don't. We charge them $0 over and above the model, because eXp offers such an attractive model based on their revenue share programs. We do not have to charge an extra split overriding the brokerage split to make it attractive for our agents. We can offer systems, tools, lead platforms, automations, CRMs, daily phone calls, daily masterminds. We can offer private community hubs. We can offer social media training to the highest capacity in the entire marketplace. And we do that over and above multiple hours of online training a day. We do that over and above 24/7 access to tech support and admin support and administrative support. No other independent brokerage can even close to compete with that. But now let's focus on the entire subject of the video. What did Ryan Serhant do wrong? He's built an amazing personal brand. He's built a brand that everybody recognizes. So he thought it made a lot of sense to make a real estate brokerage named after him. And you know, he was half right. Building an organization named after him would have made a ton of sense, and it still does. Him merging that entire brokerage in with EXP as Serhant and building an organization around that would be way more valuable to him. Why? Because if he builds out to, let's say, 100 agents at his firm, those 100 agents are not as valuable as the 10,000 agents, let's just give an example, that he would get if he had an unrestricted opportunity. If he could get agents in Canada, the UK, Australia, if he could get them in South Africa, if he could have agents that want to partner with him in Florida, in Arizona, in Montana. But right now, he doesn't have that opportunity. And very likely, according to the statistics, it's very unlikely that he'll ever have his real estate brokerage move outside of New York. Now, if it does, he'll probably focus on a few small ultra luxury marketplaces like Miami, LA, and that's probably it. And maybe he'll get one outside of the country to say that they're international in a very expensive marketplace that has a lot of back and forth relocation between the cities. But the reality of that is he's building a large team, and the amount of time that it takes to build that large team makes it very cumbersome to want to continue growth. The larger it grows, the more time it takes from you because you're managing it. You're the one that's in charge of it. If you leave, your team suffers. But if you build out a revenue share organization through EXP, you have multiple partners that are also incentivized by your team that can pick up the ball when you leave. Maybe you leave for a week and you actually want to go on vacation. Well, when you're the brokerage owner, it's very, very difficult to get away. You have questions, you have admin support, you have tech support, unless you've hired all that out. And if you hire all that out with paid staffed positions, you're not gonna have any profit at all. If you paid out transaction coordinators, staff, front desk administrators, office managers, managing brokers to manage the paperwork compliance, you have tech support and legal, and when you add up all the salaried employees, there is going to be zero profits left. So how do you actually make profit and make it so that you can build time freedom in this business at all? That's a very hard question. Now, what I'll say is it's very difficult to do that cash flow wise by building and owning a real estate brokerage. What I will also say is that let's say you wanted to get out of the business altogether. Now, with the EXP opportunity, you can just maintain your license, stop selling homes, and continue getting revenue share checks. And I'm not going to say any warranties or claims, but it's most likely that your organization is probably going to continue to grow when you choose to retire, because there's agents that work with you and even above you or below you in the structure that are likely going to want to build their own. And if they're building and you're not, you're still likely growing. And the alternative to that is building an entire real estate brokerage, and you build the brokerage up and you get to, say, 100 agents, and you realize that you don't want to run the brokerage anymore. What does an exit opportunity actually look like in those scenarios? Because people never think about the end scenario. The end scenario of a real estate brokerage is potentially a sale or cash funding to pivot out. Those are the two options. The cash funding to pivot out is very, very, very difficult to do, because the more agents you get, the more staff, the more support, the more overhead expenses, the more office spaces you typically have to acquire. Now, when you look at the sales side of things, right now the marketplace is paying 2.5 times the net profits. That's it. So let's say pretend, you are a wildly profitable 100 agent brokerage, and you are making $400,000 a year. That would be a wildly profitable 100 person brokerage. It would be a very, very successful one. Everybody would know it in the marketplace. It would be doing very, very well. Now, if you did, that means your brokerage is worth $1 million. Now, let's pretend that you were actually able to get somebody who wanted your brokerage, because first off, it's very hard to sell, because now if you're doing that well, you've built out a quality brand. People probably like, know, and trust you and the staff that you've built and the brand that you've built. And so let's say that you came out with a brand that had very similar ethos, very similar identity, very similar branding strategies, and they were willing to take you on and pay this 2.5 times your nets. And let's say you got the $1 million. Now, the problem is they're not going to give you $1 million. They're going to give you 33% of that up front, which means that you're actually going to take a pay cut on your first year. So let's say you're going to make $300,000 this year, and they're going to pay it over 3 years. So now instead of $400,000, you're going to make $333,000, and you're going to have to still work there. They're going to require that you hold a contract for 2 to 3 years of that term. Now, when you hold that contract, you're going to make less money because they're going to pay you less than 3 times, and usually they're 3-year contract periods. So you're going to make less than you were already making. And then when you go through the period of time, if you don't retain your agents, you start to lose money. So let's say the 100 goes down to 80 because they didn't like the transfer. Well, that means then the next year, instead of 333, you might be looking at 250. And then the next year, maybe you lose some of those 80 and you go to 70. Now you're down to 230. But then at the end of 3 years, you no longer own a brokerage and you're left with nothing. That's what happens in a buyout. Or let's pretend it goes the other way. You go to the 100 and then it actually goes really well. You don't win on the upside of the equation at all. So say you get to 120, 130 agents, it continues growing. Well, that entire time you're going to get your $333,000. And at the end of 3 years, they're going to give you a handshake and a thank you. And then you're left with nothing. You've gotten your $1 million over the earnout period of 3 years. And that's it. Now you have to rebuild, create a new business, figure out what next to do. Or you can consider doing the same thing that I did. You can consider diverting everybody's expectations and doing the total opposite of what people would expect. We merged our 137 agents into EXP. And then after a 4-month period of time, gained 85 agents. That's almost the entirety of the brokerage it took me 4 years to build. And building that size of a brokerage in 4 years is almost unheard of from the beginning. It's very, very difficult to grow to that size, let alone in a small period of time. And we built, since our merge with EXP, 85 agents in a 4-month period of time. So if you extrapolate the way that this growth curve is going to work, it's most likely that we will be at near 500 agents at a year mark, or maybe a year and a half, at 2-year mark, 3-year mark, let's say in 3 years, because that's the earnout period of a purchase option. In 3 years, it's most likely that I'll have 1,000 agents that work with me across the globe. And I will most likely be making $1 million per year in passive residual income through the organization of EXP. And that's assuming I continue specific growth and assuming lots of different things in the marketplace. So I'm not going to make any hard and fast claims, but it's likely that I run a 1,000-person organization that pays me wildly more than what the earnout period would be. And it's not just for 3 years. It's going to be for the rest of my life. And it's willable. So what happens when you own a brokerage and unfortunately you pass away? Does your significant other or your family have the wherewithal or the competence or the aptitude to run and operate an entire real estate brokerage? The answer for, I'm guessing, 99% of you is no. This is not their field of expertise. This is not what they would be capable of doing. It's not the venture that they would probably do very well in. So what would happen in that instance is they'd probably have to sell it off to the best of their ability for basically dimes on the dollar, because they'd have to get rid of it because of the liabilities. And that's assuming all the agents didn't run for the hills the second they realized the ownership had passed. And the alternative is you work with us at eXp and all of those people stay, because all of the entire upline is there, all of the value stack is still there. And then could your significant other or your family that you name come in and say, get a real estate license, and that's it? Could they do that? If they could, they could be continuing to receive all of the passive residual income that you'd built up without having to do anything, without having to be a broker, without having to do the paperwork review with the compliance and added all of that extra legal liability to their plate while dealing with your passing. You're going to be able to actually know that you're leaving them with something that's real and that's tangible and that will always be there. And probably, like I said before, probably continue to grow if you've partnered with the right people. So if this is at all interesting to you and you don't want to make the same mistake that Ryan Serhant did and is still making, please consider partnering with me, or even at least setting a phone call with me so we can have a further conversation on all of the specifics. It took a long time for me to actually look at the model without a lot of emotion and with actually looking at the data, the facts, and the figures before I actually removed my emotion. I had running jokes about it at my office. It was the most bashed real estate brokerage that I've ever seen in my entire life by me, until I actually looked at it. And once I did, I couldn't unsee the truth behind the model, is that a high producing agent should be nowhere else. Somebody that has a team or wants to grow influence or wants to be a coach, wants to be able to help other agents grow and flourish, should be nowhere else. Somebody who wants to own a real estate brokerage should be nowhere else, because if you look at the core of what you're doing and building a real estate brokerage for, you are primarily doing it for time freedom, financial freedom, and to have a bigger impact on the world. And the only thing that partnering with us will do is allow you to extend every single one of those benefits and alleviate every single one of the brokerage ownership negatives of the liabilities, the adult daycare, the paperwork review, the legal problems. You get to alleviate yourself from all of that, all of the geographic boundaries of your ability to give impact, and you get to expand all of what your brand is, what you do, and how you do it to the rest of the world. Again, consider liking and subscribing to the channel. Please leave a comment if you have anything to say. I will get to every single one of them. And if you want to learn more about brokerage ownership, just connect with me anytime. I'll talk to you guys later.